Namaste and greetings. I, DBAT, researcher and assistant editor at IMPRI, Impact and Policy Research Institute, Prabhav Evang Niti Anusandhan Sansthan, Nayi Delhi, extend my warmest welcome to you all to IMPRI hashtag Web Policy Talk. Today, we are gathered for a special panel discussion on reopening of schools amid COVID-19, challenges and the way forward for children's education as a part of the State of Education hashtag Education Dialogue. This event is organized by IMPRI, Center for ICT for Development, and IMPRI Impact and Policy Research Institute, New Delhi. Now, let me take this moment to introduce the gathering. As the chair for today's session, we have with us Professor Sachidanand Sinha. He's a professor at the Center for Study of Regional Development, Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. We welcome you, sir. Moving to our esteemed panelists for today, we have with us Piyush Prakash, who is the Senior Associate of Education Vertical, Niti Aayog, Government of India. We are honored to have you, sir. We are delighted to have with us Manushi Yadav from Pratham Education Foundation, currently heading the strategic partnerships. In the past, she had led program management for Pratham's education programs, leading teams that work with state and program to plan, track, document, and review its programs. We welcome you, ma'am, to the session. We are pleased to be joined by Susheta Bhatt, the CEO of Dream a Dream Bengaluru, a nonprofit organization that empowers children from vulnerable backgrounds to overcome adversity and thrive in a fast-changing world. Welcome you, ma'am. Also, we have with us Meeta Sengupta, who is a founder of Center for Education Strategy, New Delhi, and also a fellow of Salzburg Global Seminar. We are pleased to have you with us, ma'am. Welcome to the session. Now,
good to be here. I just want to point out I'm shutting down the Center for Education Strategy.
Now, I invite our chair, Professor Sachidanand Sinha, to initiate the discussion with his opening remarks and to proceed with the discussion. We look forward to learning from our esteemed gathering. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, IMPRI, for giving me this opportunity to be on such a distinguished panel. Coming straight to the topic that we have for discussion today, you know, nearly after two years, close to about 2 years, the schools have finally opened, although in a limited way. We have experienced, or rather we are experiencing, the outcome at different levels in different ways. The Delhi University admission is certainly an important indication of how things are likely to emerge if, you know, we are going to miss out on so many accounts. We have, and the major reason as to why we have a much bigger challenge before us are the two facets of the impact of the COVID and the closure of schools. One, of course, is for the rural population. There one has to be particularly concerned about what is really happening with the deprived sections, because they are the ones who, in fact, are on the edge of attendance or attending schools and dropping out and so on and so forth. So they really have a much greater challenge before themselves. Also because, you know, they suffer from multidimensional poverty of various intensities and magnitudes. On the other hand, you know, we also have people who have some kind of some resources to access education for their children through online technologies. And we know that for sure, that, and that has been my experience as well, taking online classes, that not many of us can afford that technology. The NSSO has brought that out very clearly, that, you know, there is a huge digital gap. But the impact that the families and the households have had as a consequence of online
Has sir lost his voice, or is there a problem? Sir, please unmute.
Sachita, please unmute.
There is some internet issue. So please unmute.
Okay, yeah, sorry. So there are a number of issues, and I think, you know, the panelists would certainly bring about through their own experiences, through the organizational initiatives that they have made during this particular period, along with the government, state governments. It's very important for us to also understand that, you know, it's not a centralized kind of a structure that the educational system in India follows. It is highly decentralized. We have many organizations and agencies, both government and outside government, private and public, who have been providing education. And what has been their role in this process? We do keep reading about, you know, the schools, children, you know, moving out from private schools because of the decline in income, family income, and so on and so forth, moving on to government schools. We have also been reading about, you know, several schools coming under some kind of a scanner by the government, particularly in Delhi, for having raised the tuition fees and so on and so forth. So there are a number of, a variety of issues, and all these are likely to impact both the supply side and the demand side of education. But our commitment under RTE to take education to every child as a state, as a society, I think that remains, that is non-negotiable, and therefore, come what may, whatever be the cost, you know, we cannot really take things in a manner in which perhaps one could say, well, you know, this was just a small disruption, and that, you know, once this
So I was talking about disruption, and there was a disruption. Yeah, I think so I was about to hand over the proceedings to our panelists. So could we have our first panelist, Arjun?
Sure. Arjun, do you have anything to add, or shall I start?
Yes, our first panelist, Manushi Adhoman from Pratham Education Foundation. Please go on.
Thank you. And I'm so sorry. I feel like I was looking at the internet challenges, and I'm worried that I might be facing similar issues. So just mention this before we start. I think the professor wants to say something.
Yes, professor.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Please unmute,
sir. Unmute. I think, you know, without wasting time, because, you know, network, it seems, is quite unstable. Although I've got three different networks and all of them are unstable, I don't know what to do. Maybe their problem is somewhere else. But I think, you know, let's get over to the panelists, and I'll invite Manushi Yadavji from Pratham to share her ideas on the issue that we have.
Sure. Thank you so much. And thank you, Arjun, for having me here with this panel. You know, before I start, actually, as I start, I was thinking that what is the background on which we operate? I think it would be very important to understand. But before any of that, I think I would just mention that I'm coming from the experiences that Pratham Education Foundation has had over the last, you know, 25 years, of course, but also the last 18 months specifically operating during COVID. So a lot of my learnings are coming from focusing on getting children engaged, making sure that, you know, they receive some kind of input during this time. And most of the work has been focused on ensuring that we build strong foundations. So I will steer clear of, you know, talking about facts like Delhi University admissions or higher education. I think I will very much stick to what I understand somewhat better. And as I was trying to think of, you know, something that paints a picture of the problem. So I think at Pratham, using the annual status of education survey, we are very used to just trying to explain the problem in a very simple, you know, one line statement. We say that, you know, we have almost 97% children across the country who are in rural parts of the country who are enrolled in school as per the survey. But we have almost 50% of fifth graders who cannot read a grade 2 level text, a simple text, excuse me. And to just compare this to what we are seeing today, we recently did an exercise, you know, in earlier this year in the state of Karnataka, surveyed almost 18,000, more than 18,000 children as part of the ASSAR survey, and tried to compare it to what we saw in the state of Karnataka in the last ASSAR survey that we done in 2018. And some of the stats, which, you know, instead of going into the whole table, and the data, of course, is available on the ASSAR Center website, if I compare the grade 2 of 2018 with the grade 2 of what we saw in 2021, we had 17% children then who could not recognize, you know, even a single letter. So we call them beginner, right? And this year, that data was at 31.8%. So it's almost doubled. And if I take a, you know, grade 4, the child who would have been in grade 2 at that point of time, at that time, at a grade 4 level, we had 5.1% children who were beginners. And this year, that's 12%. So we can see that the number, the data kind of tells us that this cohort is, you know, so much further behind than the cohort that was in 2018, which was not at a great place to begin with, right? So these levels of children who will enter classroom without being able to recognize a letter, these levels have almost doubled. And this is just Karnataka. So keeping that in mind, I think when we are talking about school reopening, we've been very clear at looking at this exercise in, you know, in phases. There is a phase right before schools reopen where you can't just expect children to have an 18-month pause and come back to school, you know, completely ready to learn. Yes, there should be excitement, and children are excited. As we work in communities, we see children very eager to learn. But getting them to a point where coming to school will actually add value to their learning is a very important part. So we've been talking about making sure that before children come to school, there should be a lot of focus on readiness or warm-up kind of work that kind of gets them in a place where they can leverage what is happening inside the classroom. And that can be done very well locally, through mothers for younger children, through local volunteers, through the community that has been with these children for this entire time. And it can also just ensure that, you know, you are not focusing on, you know, what we call literacy or numeracy. It needs to be a lot more holistic, because a child who will enter grade 2 early next year has never actually been to school. Right, we don't know what the Anganwadi situation was like, what was the preschool education like. So you have to focus on something which is very comprehensive. And then once the child comes to school, there is a period of, you know, getting to know the child again, right? It shouldn't be that, you know, you come inside the classroom and I'm expecting to follow the usual practices of your pre-COVID time. So making sure everyone is coming in, tracking children well from, you know, especially the vulnerable age groups, the adolescent girls, marginal communities, making sure they're coming inside, getting to know them one-on-one through simple assessments like USR so that you know what they need, right? What kind of dose you need to give to them. And ensuring that you understand your classroom well enough that you can track their attendance, right? That's an important part. And throughout this period, I think one of the things that will work really well is strong school and community connections. Like Professor said, a lot of this is it's not fully central, right? There are state-specific situations, there will be district-specific situations. You know, cases may rise in one particular area, you may have to shut schools again. It's going to be a very, very dynamic situation. And we need to make sure that if there is a lockdown again, sporadic ones at local level, teachers have the ability to continue being in touch with the child even when they are in the household. So making sure that the community and school connections are good is very important. And then comes, you know, what do I do inside the classroom? That's the final phase and extremely important because, you know, experience tells us that there is a lot of reliance on our very, very aspirational curriculum that we have. And that has to be, you know, put aside for a while. We really need to focus on a very clear strategy for catch-up. We advocate wherever we were working with governments, we're advocating for what we call a 100-day catch-up or something like that, a campaign which is catchy, which everyone can fall behind, and which allows you to know that, you know, for at least this period of time, my focus is only to get children to read, to recognize numbers, to do basic stuff before I reintroduce them to the, you know, very, very aspirational curriculum that we have. And I think that is something that needs to be adopted statewide, centrally, however, but it can't be left to every single teacher because once school reopen, if you once again start following your annual curriculum and your annual calendars that are created, we will lose out on, you know, the cohort, this cohort of 2 years will actually lose out on a lot of things. So getting them ready, making sure they get to catch up and staying connected with their homes and communities. I think these are some of the key things that we have to keep in mind as we, you know, talk about reopening. And I guess that is where I'll pause. That is my contribution to actually get the conversation started. And over to you, Meeta.
Thank you so much. This was so beautiful and so comprehensive that I do not think any of us have much more to add to this. We are all in vehement agreement that getting children back into schools is going to be an exercise in adjustment. In a way, what is happening right now because of the disruption that we have faced is that we have the past, which was one universe in education, and what we are building now is the future, which is another whole universe that we are not ready to face up to. We are not brave enough to face up to the fact that so much has changed in our teachers and our schools. And what we are doing right now is simply creating that little setu, that little bridge from that past to this future. And in doing that, I think what we have in front of us, this is not what I had planned to say at all, but I am so enthused by what you have said. That I really want to focus on this bridge that we are building. Because the bridge that we are building has to now remember that one, we did make some mistakes in the past. We didn't get everything right. With all the best of intentions, the best of funding that we could afford, the best of teachers we could manage to train, we still got some things wrong. For example, the empathy and the kindness part of it. The community connect, because we were so wonderfully competitive that we forgot that education is about building and raising communities. Education is about social and economic mobility. So many things were forgotten because, of course, we had to rush ahead. India, especially as a country, had been left behind in so many ways. We had to rush ahead and do the essentials. But now we are, the metaphor I use is that imagine you're renovating your house. You find that there are lots of leaks in your house, some windows don't work. Maybe you want to reposition a door somewhere. Now, when you're going to find the materials for this, you will correct the mistakes of the past and you will say, hang on, actually, I should be doing this in this new way. And this new way includes the elements that you spoke about. The 100-day catch-up curriculum is a great way of doing it. I know Dream a Dream is going to talk about the social and emotional aspects of it, so I don't need to belabor that. I want to hear more about it from them. But really, our students have been through another womb in the sense. And this is a rebirth of our student and teacher life. So I, if we are able to, and the chrysalis is another beautiful metaphor for it, that when we emerge as a butterfly, let us emerge as a stronger and better butterfly, a stronger and better creature in this world of education. And how do we structure this thinking? I would like to actually propose a framework because we are talking amongst specialists over here. And I would like to say that let us look at two aspects. One, the people here, the students and the teachers primarily. And there, and Professor Sachinandanand has spoken about the digital divide already. The digital divide does not exist only for the students. It has existed for the teachers also. Many of us were digital immigrants as teachers. Many of us had to suddenly learn what to do. As students, even in higher education, many of us went back to our villages and we could not go to that spot in the village where we could get that signal exactly when the lessons were being done. There were this whole range, a whole spectrum of issues when we talk about the digital divide. So one axis over here is the people and what do we do with it? And the other axis is the pedagogy. And I want to talk a little bit more about pedagogy because I hear so much across reports that our students have suffered because we were not able to deliver good remote learning online. Therefore, this is not causation, but this is the therefore that we hear across reports. Therefore, online education is bad. That is a terrible take to take. Because what we were doing is jugaad online education. We were remote online education. We did not have digital pedagogies in place at all. We were simply saying, this is what I, a classroom teacher, knows how to do when I'm teaching. Can I simply switch on a button, learn how to operate the buttons on a website and call that teaching? That works really well in the classroom situation. That does not work as we have proved. Your numbers, exactly the 17% to 32%, the 5 to 12% prove that the old ways do not work when we are doing remote learning. But we also know that remote learning is, in theory, in logic, very good for remote communities. It is wonderful for women who are restricted to the home and who cannot actually go to school in the designated hours of school. It is excellent for adult learning. It's excellent for catch-up learning, for those who were dropouts at school, et cetera. There are so many developmental advantages and economic mobility advantages to remote learning. This back to school for us should not only be about the two cohorts that we are talking about. This back to school has to be about lifelong learning, has to be about the learning lag that we always knew about. And thank you very much, Asar, for talking about it for all of these years. You were literally talking about the learning lag and nobody was listening. I mean, everybody was listening to you because you provided numbers, but nobody was doing as much about it as they are encouraged to do right now. So this learning lag, the developmental learning lag, is something that we can fix right now. So I'm not going to belabor the two axes and talk about how it forms a 2x2 grid. I'm writing a paper on that and I will happily share that with all of you. And I would look forward to inputs on that, especially from the audience as well. I would love to hear inputs. I'm on Twitter and the IMPRI website is on Twitter. So would love to hear inputs on that. But I think there are a few lessons that we need to learn for the immediate future. So what I've talked about so far is the broad overall planning that we need to do. Saying that we need to plan for people and we need to plan for pedagogies. And for people as in students and teachers who retain traditional classroom pedagogies, who move over to hybrid learning and therefore have some element of digital pedagogies and classroom pedagogies. And we need to plan for the new hybrid world where we can build more access with more affordability, we can now do things with technology that we could not do 10 years ago. ICT for development was a movement even in 2010. But there was no momentum behind it in India. There were no pedagogies being developed for it that actually worked in the classrooms. This is the time because now we have teachers' support, we have teachers' experience, we have amazing micro innovations from the ground. So this is when we build on all of these. Finally, just wanted to also pick on something that was said before and needs reiteration. Not just the socialization into learning as we catch up, not just the social and emotional learning. I think we also have an opportunity for equity in the classroom. So the way I remember it myself, because now I'm growing old and I forget things without writing notes, the notes I had written for myself is socialization, socializing, and socialism, not using the word socialism in the technical sense at all. But just as a mind, a mnemonic to myself, these three aspects are going to be critical to the rebuilding of curriculum and student life over here. The one thing that we learned, for example, is those who were less able to handle classroom structures, such as those who were neurodiverse, or those who were shy, or those who were bullied, actually found that teachers made a huge effort, because now you did not have the constraints of the classroom of the front bench and the last bench. There were no back benches anymore. Everybody was equal on a screen. And a teacher was actually able to make that effort equally for all. Now, of course, it's true that that didn't work out perfectly, which goes back to the digital pedagogies that I'm talking about. But it will be made to work because they made an effort and 20 out of 100 times it worked well. Let's find out what those 20 people did right. What they got right to bring equity into the classroom. You have one flat screen over here. This is something that was proved with MOOCs as well, quite in 2013, 2014, with varied results. And finally, I would like to say that let us not forget that this is another opportunity for empowering and motivating our teachers, because and giving them much more decision-making power over how they manage their classrooms. Because this disruption actually is a localized disruption. And their response to it will have to be localized. You will have one entire state or one entire country with little pockets of COVID outbreaks, for example. And I'm using COVID specifically over here. So it is going to be the COVID clusters and the non-COVID clusters. And this speaks to the NEP concept of school clusters, though it reframes and redefines it. The NEP does not speak of clusters specifically in this format, but in the way it is written, the text is written of the new education policy, it actually lends itself very, very well to the decision-making that is responsive to the needs of that area cluster. With the school not necessarily as something with four walls, iron grills, and a gate with a chowkidar and CCTV, but school as a hub for learning, and the teacher as the inspiration for learning, where you keep going back to them. We already have excellent examples of that. The doubt clearing sessions are the most beautiful example of hybrid learning that already happens in class 11 and 12. We have many of these in place. And I will pause over here saying that we just need to learn from ourselves to be able to build a future that works for us.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Meeta. Yes, I think there's just so much already covered. I can only add to the conversation that we are having already. So I want to take on aspects from both what Manushi said as well as Meeta said. So first is just this idea of learning loss. And while I fully subscribe to it, and I'm fully, obviously, the data is showing us that it's real and it's happened and children are not at expected learning levels. I want to just really make it real about why that happens, not just during COVID, but even otherwise, why that happens. And just when you look at COVID, right, this is what children have gone through in this last 18 months. So while school has been closed, they have not had access to their communities, their peers, access to teachers, friends, and their whole life was turned upside down overnight. What what children, especially from marginalized backgrounds, have experienced in addition is there is a loss of income and livelihood. We know there's going to be a higher dropout of children who are not going to be able to come back just because they can't afford it anymore. So they are living with the anxiety of loss of income and livelihood in the middle of a possible medical emergency while family members have passed on and they've gone through the grief of all of that. We know there has been migration. Children who were going into schools were, have migrated back to their local villages, to their native villages. And we know that we will have a huge dropout because of that. But also the emotional toll that migration took. Migration was not easy. We have seen almost 5 lakh, 6 lakh people walking on the roads with children. What has been the emotional toll on those children? Again, looking at the death and devastation of the migration carry. We know that children are being forced to become adults. When you don't go to school, you typically then join either the inorganized market to inorganized workforce to earn income for your family. Or if you're a girl, you typically start taking care of your younger siblings, managing household chores. So they're both forced to become adults before their time. There's so much confusion and misinformation, whether it's news channels which sensationalize only bad news, or it's WhatsApp, fake news spreading through WhatsApp, Facebook. There's just so much fake news and rumors that are floating around. We know there are heightened violence and abuse. Children who are stuck at home with abusers, we've had exponential increase in SOS calls to the Childline India because children have been stuck at homes with their abusers. They're in captivity. We know that the impact is gendered. Girls have faced more impact than boys, and they have faced more domestic violence and abuse at home. So all of this has led to this higher level of anxiety, right? Children have come through such a stressful time, which is already typically stressful if you're coming from a marginalized background. Added to this, there's a huge loss of dignity, confidence, just self-esteem that children experience. So while I'm all for this 10-day reintegration, 100 days reintegration, the foundational reintegration as well as later on must be also on the social and emotional health of children. We must be able to take into account the stress and anxiety that they have gone through. Today's Bangalore Mirror is talking about generally how there is more mental health challenges across Bangalore, right? These are just regular people. We must assume that this is many times over when you're a child who has no control over this and had no way to know what the future would look like. So one is to accept and respond to it, respond to the social emotional challenges that children are going through, the mental health issues that we are going to see, which are going to surface as one dropout itself. But even when they turn up, you will see behavioral challenges. You will see, like Manushri said, not being able to read and write. All of those we are going to see, and how are we going to take that into account? And from the little bit we are hearing of how schools are reopening, they're almost taking the opposite stance. They're like, syllabus complete karo, extra karo, morning come to classes, afternoon may go to online education, homework, catch up, notes, right? It's almost the opposite response that you would expect when children are coming back from this much trauma. So I just wanted to humanize the trauma itself that children have gone through. And in terms of the response, I again fully agree with what Amita said, that people and pedagogy is very important. And to build on that, to build on the idea of people, pedagogy, and this idea of equity, right? I feel that I get the point that Mita is making, that in an online class, equity can also be achieved because there are no backbenchers. I would really invite us to think about equity in education with a much larger lens, considering that there has been so much disruption. Is it time to really reimagine the purpose of education itself? Today, education is such a funnel-based, exclusionary approach that we have that finally it is only a few people that are quote-unquote considered successful, right? We already know that dropouts itself increases as you go up to higher education. If you consider IIT as the benchmark, today considered the typical benchmark of success, it's such a small person. The whole approach to education is how can you keep excluding children so that you have this small funnel and a small percentage of people who are finally considered successful, and typically then a big measure of that is you leave India, right? So how can we really expand the definition of success? How can we take equity into account? How can we take children not only different learning levels, different backgrounds, different social identities, make education truly inclusive in its intent and use this opportunity today where COVID shut down schools for 18 months to say, let's take a step back and ask ourselves, can we do something not just better, but something fundamentally different? Is it time to build back very, very differently, recognizing that what we had didn't serve us, and we potentially have an opportunity right now to do something very different. So yeah, that would be my opening remarks.
Thank you very much, Manushi, Mita, and Sucheta, for your remarks on the current challenges in school education as well as the entire spectrum of education. I think we have got pretty good points to in fact look at and deliberate upon and think over. You know, when we are talking about learning outcomes, you know, it's not a very, I mean, we have been seeing this. Pratham reports have been there, you know, and now NCERT has also joined through national assessments and so on and so forth. That is irrespective of whether we have we had COVID or no COVID. So therefore, you know, a much deeper understanding of why we have this kind of an outcome, learning outcomes. And you know, it's one thing that we have recognized the problem, but we haven't really understood as to what are the causes that lead to this. Is it that, you know, we have been happy doing what in one of the reports Pratham also says, and since, you know, Manushi is there from Pratham, so I'm positing this question, not question and observation, that, you know, they are not averse to multi-grade classrooms. I'm a product of a multi-grade classroom myself, you know, where there was a teacher and, you know, we had five classes. So, you know, in that kind of situation, especially in such formative years, when you are in class one or preschool, how does that happen? And so, you know, there is a lot that we got to really talk about teachers. And that's where, you know, I think your 100 days of keeping the curriculum aside makes tremendous, it's a very relevant point that you have made. The question is that, you know, how these 100 days of keeping curriculum aside is likely to be translated into some kind of an activity. And within a school, at home, or whatever be the spectrum of areas, because children learn from everywhere. It doesn't really need to be the four walls of school. So, you know, have we really done something to, in fact, work with teachers? I mean, orienting teachers, because they have the institutional responsibility and they have directly, besides parents, have we really engaged parents? Have we really engaged communities? I mean, during this period, I had an opportunity to going back to some of the villages, you know, and I started taking classes in small groups. My wife was doing that for nearly 1.5. I mean, she was there and she has been there all through, and she is doing that. But then, you know, the experiences were that, you know, at one end, you know, she was afraid that, you know, even if there are more than five or maybe whatever be the number, if there is something that happens. So there is a need for a kind of a community-based structures to emerge, along with the support that teachers perhaps could obtain from the institutional structure, so that, you know, and this is very important, what Meeta said, that the teachers should be given the decision-making power. I'm really sorry to say this. While, you know, we talk about teachers having been given the decision-making process, in fact, on ground, just the reverse. It's just the opposite. I mean, you talk to any group of teachers, whether teaching at the primary level or or whatever level of school education, university education itself has become so much centralized, not only in terms of curricular structures, but also in terms of the entire process, which in fact was not supposed to have been. It was supposed to be very, very decentralized. NEP itself supports centralization in a certain way. So one can bring that and see as to what really happened. It's very important that you know what our documents say in one place and what is really happening on the ground. What I'm really pointing out is, Sucheta perhaps could be lending some understanding on this. You know, in Karnataka, they were trying to rationalize schools, rationalize teachers. In several states, you know, this process began. And in Jharkhand, I know of the fact that, you know, there have been a few thousand schools which were closed down even before the pandemic. And during the pandemic, you have a very well-declared program by the government of Madhya Pradesh, which says that they are going to close down 1.2 or maybe 1.1 lakh schools and only keep 12,000 schools open, because they would be the schools, you know, which will really be like, you know, the centers of excellence and so on and so forth. Is it very different from what we have really done over the years? That, you know, whenever we wanted to really, you know, we have created this kind of a antagonism between quantity and quality without even understanding that, you know, there is no such thing called quantity versus quality. You know, this whole assumption that if you have larger classrooms, you cannot really, yes, it is going to have certain kind of an impact on the pedagogical processes, the way you develop. Say, for example, in our university, we have term paper systems. We ask students to make presentations within a 3.5 month duration of the term of a semester. And it's very, very intense. I mean, along with several other kinds of assignments, which have to be carried out between the teacher and the student. And I can tell you that has been learning on the either side. I mean, the teachers have learned so much in the process. In fact, interacting with the students one-to-one basis. But you know, when we withdraw this kind of what we can call it freedom, and there is none that I know of in government schools, be it government schools or private schools, then you know, where do we really situate in the new circumstances that Meeta was talking about, where teachers could perhaps share their micro innovations, and to the extent that these micro innovations could perhaps become a kind of a learning process for both the community, but where is the community? What is that community? We know of it only in sociological terms, but do we really know it in practical terms? I mean, you've got to really look at the way the rural landscapes have undergone a kind of a transformation. I work in rural areas, and I cannot really say that I know everything, but whatever little that I know about it, and I know that, well, you know, there was a community of whatever nature, all the very, very stratified community when I was a child in my village. Today, you know, along with that, those kinds of stratified structures, which of course all of us very know it very well, you know, they have extended or they have incorporated many other dimensions of stratification. The structures on the ground have become far more difficult. And therefore, you know, I'm really impressed by the fact that, you know, in our discussion, we have also talked about the social and emotional challenges of children, especially in rural areas, especially from those sections where, you know, they had no other option because they were not learning. So they could be either playing what the probe report said, you know, that, you know, it's better if they're not learning, let them do some work, you know, so you force them into work. The abuses, children becoming orphans. I mean, we have no idea. I mean, we only know it through a kind of a wind that is coming into our rooms through the windows. The kind of devastation that has taken place. It was not just a few lakhs of people who walked, those who did not walk, and the kind of tragedies that they have experienced. They are still finding it very difficult to, in fact, come back to some kind of a norm. So, you know, ICT, to the extent, you know, it can be made an important way through which, you know, we could address certain aspects. But, you know, this at this formative stage, when we are talking of children in schools, be they at the elementary level or the senior or the secondary level, and the secondary level children are undergoing a very different kind of a age-related, emotional-related kind of challenges, you know, so they have a very different kind of a set of problems, you know, and so every age has its own set of problems. And where do we really, I mean, that would be my observation, my concern is, what are those three things, or maybe a half a dozen things that, you know, we could do as a community, as citizens of this country? I think most of us sitting here, besides, I mean, excluding me, we are part of some kind of an organizational framework which has been working with children. I think, you know, there is a lot that, you know, needs to be looked at in terms of even a very small or a fraction of successes. And that is what I think Meeta talked about, micro innovations. We got to really record these experiences. And, you know, we got to go to the field, as Meeta said, you know, there is no way out. You know, if we have to really understand it, and, you know, this, the course of action before we, and we are already late, we have not been into the fields. So what Manushi was indicating at back to school means back to the curriculum, you know, and then, you know, once you are back to curriculum, then back to the same kind of an, you know, normal routine, lecturing in the class and checking their. But all said and done, you know, we got to really look at one thing that we should engage ourselves is that what is really happening on the ground, especially as to what are the changes that the state is implementing, with what intention, you know, that is something which will go on whether you build whatever kind of resilience.
Can you hear us, Sachi sir?
I think sir, it has again faced some connection issue. Yeah, sir is here again.
So please unmute, Sachi sir.
So that shows what has been our collective concern. As a society, we have not deliberated upon these things, you know, at whatever level, at the level of the public forum. So I think, you know, we got to do something. Those 5-6 important course of action, what we expect from the institutions and the agencies of the states, what we really and how we really go about reorganizing and maybe bringing the community, particularly those who are at a loss, at a tremendous loss. Those who have the resources, you know, they will find out, although there are issues there also, but you know, they will have the wherewithal to in fact emerge out of it. But those who are at the bottom of this, pyramid, and they are not few, there are a large number of them. And what will really happen to some of them? As we all know that it is not only a question of learning outcomes, it's also a question of, you know, understanding that, you know, education will enable a certain kind of mobility, will create a situation of certain degree of dignity and self-esteem. But can we really say that in our schools, you know, everybody, every child is being treated as equal, as Mita was really trying to say? There is so much that is discursive and non-discursive kind of behavioral things that goes on almost at every level, at every moment, which tends to further accentuate what Sucheta talked about, the problem of exclusion. You know, children are not attending a school not because their parents cannot pay, or they do not want to study, or because, you know, they are not interested in it. Of course, as a child, if you ask me, you know, whether you would like to go to a playground or maybe go to the classroom, I'll say I'll go to the playground, you know, because that's what I can do better there, and I enjoy company of my friends. But it's a very, very, I mean, challenge the scale that we have in our country. I think, you know, this has to be taken a very serious note of, and I'm really thankful to IMPRI for at least, you know, inviting such distinguished people to have contributed to this question of what are the challenges that lie ahead. And I think, you know, the organizers can invite questions from the participants. And then we know we can pool all these questions and collectively respond to them, if that is agreeable to our panelists. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sinha. Thank you so much. And thank you very much to all our panelists. Certainly there, the questions that have arisen actually showcases the persisting challenges, and also so many thoughts as we are moving forward with this new kind of education pattern that is developing. So I would like to share the questions with you, and some of these are actually directed towards some of the panelists. So I would also read out the names so you could take notes, and then we could go on with the discussion. So the first question is for Namita ma'am. Do you think that digital pedagogy be provided for the teachers first and then move to the pupils? To what extent the state support can be provided for this? And teachers, as you know, are underpaid. Even those with PhDs earn very meager amounts. So definitely they cannot be compelled to pay for accessing digital pedagogy. This is very important question. Then a question is for Professor Sinha, as to, you know, teachers are partakers of the challenge of digital divide. Could you shed some light on this, sir? So Professor Sinha, would you like to open this discussion, or would you like me to pose the questions to, that have come up in the chat box?
I would like that, you know, some of the questions could be quite similar. So maybe, you know, okay. It would be better.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Another question is by Yogesh Malhotra, who asks, migration would lead to increase in dropouts as mentioned by Sucheta ma'am, and lead to rise in educational inequality. So how do we tackle this situation? The next question is by Nirmala Venkatesan, who asks, most voices agreeing for the need to reimagine education outside the formal education system. How then do we influence or bring about a systemic change across the country? Another question is, what is a feasible and inclusive way out to carry out assessments, assignments, and exams amid the pandemic when not everyone can be seamlessly online? And I think the next question is also related with this question, is that students were promoted without any exams. Certainly students were happy in general, perhaps because of the marks. But how does CBSE or Delhi University, for example, ascertain that they have actually, quote unquote, learned through their past year? This lack of understanding of basic lessons would then pose a huge challenge for the teachers again, to whom these students are assigned in the coming days. So this is quite interesting. Basically an entire cycle of learning and unlearning perhaps. Could we have the responses and then we can move to the next set.
Okay, so who would like to go first among our panelist friends?
Mine is an easy one and it was directed, so maybe I'll start very quickly. Won't take very long. The question that was directed to me was about teachers and digital pedagogies. And I think what we need over here is pedagogies for students, but definitely the teachers will have to work together to implement them. And now the good news and the bad news is, and my professor totally, I mean, one of my old professors broke my heart when he said, everything that you think of, all your new ideas have already been invented before. So that broke my heart because I thought of myself as a very smart person who was inventing new solutions. The good news for us over here is we don't have to invent new solutions. The solutions exist. So for example, NCERT has this very wonderful concept of action research. And this action research channel has not been active for a very, very long time. In other countries, led by many people here in the UK, teacher researcher is a very important pathway. All active researchers in the classroom actually engage in research on the micro innovations that they have created. And they are guided in that and supported by that by the peer community of teachers. So what we need is for teachers to be not to be trained in digital pedagogies as such, but before that to train each other in the digital pedagogies that have worked, which means A, study the digital pedagogies, bring proof that your pedagogy has worked. Did it improve marks? Did it improve, because people want to hear marks. Did it improve the engagement in the classroom? Did it make students work better together? Did it increase participation in the classroom? What did it actually achieve? So these bits of research that teachers bring together, and they can share it just as a WhatsApp group. WhatsApp is as much digital pedagogy as is a formal Microsoft Teams system or whatever. It doesn't have to be something that is scary formal, but teachers need to be able to engage in that. The second part of it, which is the cost part of it, honestly, a lot of it is going to start off by being volunteer effort. Let's be pragmatic about it. There should be state support, of course, no doubt about that. NCERT and NEOPA should be leading this entire movement of building pedagogies for teachers, for hybrid learning, for new times, etc. Yes, but those things take time. In the meantime, when teachers show momentum in that, it encourages the government to do better. So what I'm also encouraging and asking for is separate teacher pathways in digital learning. And again, we already have wonderful examples of that, content creators. So many retired teachers and teachers who have left teaching and learning are now content creators for edutech companies. This entire profession of content creators is about building digital pedagogies with the advice of real teachers who have worked in real classrooms. So again, we have solutions already in place. They need to be upgraded to meet today's needs. That's the short answer.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay, yeah.
Yes, sir.
You know, since, you know, it was about what Meeta talked about is digital divide, I think, you know, at least I do not have the experience of addressing this question at the school level, but we all know it, that, you know, what this digital divide is all about and what is the magnitude of it. how it really impacts different segments of the population. We can see the kind of network that we have while we are discussing this. And in rural areas, in smaller towns, we have digital shadows from where, nobody could connect anything. I have a class that I was teaching in the last 18 years, two batches of students, one batch has not really seen the campus so far, is studying from home. But that's besides the point. That's not the question, so I'll not reflect upon that. The digital divide or the digital kind of instruments of pedagogy, as Meeta was saying, that it provides you a lot of advantages that the teachers will have to really innovate, but it cannot be really done all by the teachers. You have to have, even if they really volunteered, even if they thought that they have to put in their 100%, the teachers as peer group, which was part and parcel of, the earlier framework where, there were cluster level resource centers and so on and so forth. But we all know that this cluster level and state level resource centers really became, and they were used for something else. I mean, I know of cluster centers which were just an extension of the office of the UDIS, where they were just collecting data. There was no peer interaction, we do have a good amount of studies saying that, wherever there has been some kind of a peer interaction, then the pedagogical aspects have certainly improved and it has worked in favor of students. But, there is a lot of possibility, yes, we can chat with one another through WhatsApp, we can communicate. I really do not know how much of these concerns we as teachers have communicated. I can tell you my own experience in this university. In every board of studies and academic council, we have been raising this question. And I was a member, now I'm not a member. So I can tell you for sure, a large number of people, let us review as to how we have to really go about having these online classes. Initially, the university was not even providing us any kind of a support. So we were going by our own expenditure. I told you I have got three connections. Precisely because it's a two-story kind of a house, so my wife was teaching upstairs, my son was working for his office in one corner, and they all wanted uninterrupted kind of a. Even with this, our reach was to the extent of nearly about 30%, I can tell you for sure. We could not reach the entire class. And the kind of interaction, you think that, there is no backbenchers. Of course, there is no backbencher, but there is somebody who has kept the phone on, but is certainly not listening, because of several other things, And, we keep saying, hey, Mr. So-and-so, Ms. So-and-so, are you around? And, then there is no response. And there a response comes because somebody has, I'm not looking at these funnier aspects of it. Maybe for children, they are sitting alongside their mother, and if somebody has two or three children, we cannot really have, new incarnation of the mother sitting with the second one or the third one, So there were stresses of all kinds, and therefore we need to really evaluate as to what are the kinds. How we can really strengthen our learning process, no matter where it comes from, whether it comes through the digital or face-to-face, and so on and so forth. The point is that, there has to be some kind of an initiative in our country. We know that for sure. If it is done by the government, if there is a program of that kind and we are made to participate, even 10-15% of those who go there, they do some learning. They do try to implement it. But rest of it, I'm not really trying to sound very pessimistic. It doesn't really happen. We have been teaching in this teachers training program. We have HRDCs and all that. You know it as to what is the way, you know, things happen there. So it has been such a wastage. I would rather call it a sheer wastage of time. You know, we are only filling in the blanks. We are filling in the charts. Yes, this task done. Yes, done. Not done. Not done. So we are just ticking the chart, you know, because it is required. Look, how much pressure do you want to be put on these teachers? You know, let's look at what they really do. I mean, some of us may not be doing much, but school teachers, they have to do so many things, you know. They would also be doing some kind of a survey of out of school children. They would also be doing survey for, you know, those who are, I mean, and now the census is knocking at the door, and most of them would be now drawn into the census enumeration. You know, we know this. It's going to happen in another few months' time. Then what is it is going to be at the cost of learning. You know, learning is going to suffer. Schools are going to suffer. And they are not superhumans. You know, they are also humans like us. They can't be doing so many things. So teachers will have to be kept in the center of this entire framework. And then, you know, something needs to be done. I mean, we've got to really raise the status, raise the dignity of the teachers, you know, because they are really somebody. And as somebody has said that, you know, they are being paid very paltry sum. I tell you this, this neoliberal framework of hiring and firing has gone down to the extent that we are justifying everything. You know, I know of such dedicated teachers, you know, who really work in the classrooms, but outside, you know, they just keep quiet because, you know, they just don't fit in into the power kind of a structure, which in fact is so very important. So let us be very true that, you know, there is a power structure, there's a stratified social structure. And then, you know, we as society, we are not amenable to the idea that somebody who has been taking orders should become our equals, you know, at any stage. So that's going to play a very, very important role, come what may. And are we as a community, are we as agents of this process prepared to face it? That's very important.
Yes, sir.
So thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Definitely, this is very important that you have added enormous insights to the discussion. Sir, going ahead, if you permit, we could move to the next question. And this question, if Sucheta ma'am could take the question on migration, which has been brought up. And also, there is another question to Sucheta ma'am from an anonymous attendee about should there be a ban in these neo-capitalist educators like Baijus and White Hats, the gap that these companies are creating in the name of latest modes of providing education to the elites and creating distress among those families who cannot afford these is immense. If you could club these and respond. Dithi, ma'am, over to you.
Yeah, I think the migration question I'm seeing is answered. So I'll take a couple of questions that have come up, including the ones that you pointed out, Dr. Mehta. So one was, you know, this question was around this conversation around reimagining education is really happening among non-formal, in the non-formal education space, right? So one is true. I agree with that. There are maybe small pockets of education reform that are conversations that are happening in the country, even in the formal education space, but by and large, it's happening in the non-formal. And I would actually say that that is potentially the power. Because even when Meeta was talking about, you know, finally people want marks, this people is the problem today also, right? That the people are actually still asking for marks. And by people, I mean everybody. Of course, the school system, the teachers and the headmasters and the entire, you know, the education ecosystem, but parents, right? Parents have a huge role to play in terms of what do they define as success and how they see their child advancing in their life and how much leverage and how much weightage they give to just marks and qualifications versus is your child really happy? Are they really doing what they want to do? Do they have the skills to handle a crisis like a pandemic instead of asking those questions? So I think that is power, that the conversation of education reform is also happening in the non-education spaces. And I do believe we can harness that and almost, you know, hopefully drive education reform even into the formal spaces of education. But to do that, there is the question of, I think there was a question around assessments. Again, Baiju's white hats, I'll put in the same thing. My opinion is I don't think in bans only because I feel any kind of sweeping power moves like that only accentuate the problem of power and how power is used that Professor Sinha spoke about. But I do believe we need regulation. I do believe that the system or the government needs to have much more regulation in everything, in capitalism in general, but definitely when the impact is on the mental health of children, is on the emotional health of children, then we do need regulation and we do need to keep Baiju's and white hats in check in terms of how much they're able to influence how children feel about themselves today. So in that same kind of line, in terms of assessments, I think there was a question of how can we reimagine assessments? How do you measure children now if they have lost 2 years of learning? And again, my invitation would be this. We have such a narrow definition of learning. In this pandemic, children have learned so much. They have learned about resilience. They've learned about grief. They've learned about managing crisis. They've learned problem solving. They've learned community engagement. They've learned online learning. They have learned so much. Can we really break out of these narrow definitions of learning and really celebrate how much children have gone through and the amount of resilience they've shown and the grit?
Very important.
To come back even to school and just to come back, to reintegrate back into the world and to society today. So really assessments are, can we expand ideas of assessments? Can we expand ideas of what success looks like? Finally leading to this future, right? This reimagination of education that I'm talking about, starting with assessments, I think it's really high time. I do have a sense that more people are talking about social emotional learning and mental health in response to the pandemic and COVID-19. But this is the reality of the future. Our children are entering a whole other world. The climate crisis is real. The capitalist, I think it's going to explode in our faces very soon. We do know that we don't know what the jobs of the future are going to look like. The complexity of the world that our children are entering is so massive. And is education really preparing them for that? Or is it still designed for a very old age and a very old system of society, right? The whole industrial system of society, which has long gone past. So can we reimagine the future from that lens? Can we reimagine education from that lens? One is that the future is very different. But I also fully subscribe to Professor Sinha's point that we need to reimagine the future from breaking down these power structures, from really breaking down these stratifications that happen based on caste, class, social identities, and really equity center education in the value of equity and use this.
And foremost gender.
And gender and poverty as well, right? Class, gender, and everything else, caste, of course, in a country like India. So use this opportunity to really do something different. That would continue to be my war cry at this point.
Yeah, war cry. Thank you so much, ma'am. I would like to pose two questions to Manushi, ma'am, about vaccination, which has been raised by Nagaraj and Krishnamurti. Vaccination for under 18 years is pending. In such a situation, they are in a higher risk of infection in spite of prevention and precautionary measures. How can we put the future at the risks that we really know about? And also the next question is about community engagement, perhaps the work that you are doing. This is a question by Alok Raj. Community engagement is often seen as most hype thing to do. Most of the time it doesn't end up the way we want. Can you please share any of the well-proven engagement activities, perhaps your own experiences, ma'am, which can be replicated on at least on a block level as part of the civil society organizations, given the divide between the teachers and parents in a government school in a rural area.
Sure. I'm going to steer clear of the vaccination question, right? I am not an expert. I would not have any background. All I can say is that there is reopening. You move out, you are seeing that there is reopening. Other things are opening up. I think just taking precaution on the policy side for schools, while everything else is pretty much back to normal, even after a very disastrous second wave, I think that's us choosing to prioritize health in one area. And like, you know, economically, we are open. But when it comes to education, we are willing to put that on hold. So I think that is just a policy level question as to where we draw the line, right? If there are precautions that can be taken on the economic standpoint, there are precautions that children can take as well. I agree that with younger children, it's trickier. But honestly, with the degree of misinformation that exists in the country and, you know, how, especially with through WhatsApp and all, I feel like children are much more sincere about wearing their masks and moving on, are the ones educating their families at some point of time. So I think we should trust our children that, okay, you put on your mask, you go to school, you maintain some distance. Options of keeping schools in the open, staying outside the classroom a little bit more can always be explored, but vaccination is something I would not comment on. I think in addition to the question you asked, the second one around community work, right? I also read through a couple of questions about, for example, what's the right example for a 100-day catch-up thing? What is it that we can do? And of course, building on what the other panelists have said, I think what is tricky when it comes to digital or remote learning is that we only think in terms of availability of a device or in terms of what the content is. The key factor that we always forget is a social structure or an ecosystem within which, you know, children sort of operate. And that is what is the main problem. It's not always about whether I have a smartphone. Even if I have an access to a smartphone for 5 hours over a course of a week, it's more than enough. So it's not that I need to have a personal smartphone. But is there someone I can turn to when I'm stuck? Is there someone who is available as a resource person even to navigate something? Right? Or who's confident in giving me a device that, you know, I will not break it. These things are crucial, and that is the divide that has grown during this period. If you come from an elite private school, you have parents who are educated, you have siblings, you have a library at home, you have reading material at home. So it's not just about digital content, it's about everything else as well. And that is where community becomes very important. So when we say a community-based intervention, we are not saying that, oh, chuck school completely, it's not necessary. We are talking about creating an ecosystem outside your house, which allows you to leverage whatever is happening everywhere else. So for example, for the last 18 months or so, what we've been doing is, immediately when schools were shut, we took our database out, saw, you know, how many numbers we have. We were connected to some 10,000 plus communities. We reached out to them via, you know, SMS and WhatsApp that, are you interested in engagement? And they were. So we shared content. So mind you very clearly that it's not just digital phone, right? We also saw which of these phones are non-smart, the old style feature phones. And for them, we reached out via SMS. So same kind of activity is going with the link of a YouTube video and all to a WhatsApp phone. And same kind of activity is going in the form of a small SMS text message to a regular feature phone. And just to make sure that, you know, we are not part of the whole ecosystem that is developing where it's like, keep on sharing digital content and sending it out in the void. We made sure that there is a two-way connection. So instead of just sending things out, we were also following up. So if it's a smartphone, then, you know, we follow up on WhatsApp. We wait for you to send us a picture of activity being done. If it's a regular phone, someone who is from your community or at least known to you pre-pandemic is calling you to check up on you. Excuse me, I have a bad throat. And that is a crucial part. And it is that practice that we have built over the last 18 months to now create what we call mohalla-wise groups. So it doesn't need to be the entire village. It doesn't need to be the entire, urban settlement. It needs to be your house and the houses right next to yours, the lane next to your house in an urban setup or a mohalla in your area. And you need a support person, a didi or a bhaiya, who is connected to a smartphone, who is connected to someone who can give them the right kind of content for you, and who ensure that, you know, somewhere during the course of the day, you take out 20 minutes to study. That is all you need, right? For a younger child, that anchor needs to be a mother. Excuse me. So we, coming, also touching upon the 100-day suggestion, right? Pratham has an approach called teaching at the right level approach, right? Which essentially is, the idea is that you don't just teach according to the class you are in or grade you're in. You are teaching according to the level the child is at. So for everything that is wrong with assessment, the answer is also assessment. Just the perspectives need to change. Instead of assessing to decide whether the child is pass or fail, you have to assess to decide, what do I do with the child? Right? So you start off with an assessment that tells you where the child is at, and you teach them accordingly. That is what we've been doing. Then there's a bunch of activities that are done in a whole classroom level, in a big group level, and small group level, so that even in a multi-grade classroom, you're actually grouping children not by their grades, but by the level at which they're at. So you have a third grader sitting with fifth grader because they both can read words, but they cannot read a letter. Cannot read a story or a paragraph, right? So that is the group that you're talking about. And this is an approach that we've been working on for the last decade and a half. It's been evaluated externally. The researchers who evaluated it won a Nobel Prize. All of that is one thing. But when the pandemic hit, instead of using Pratham trained teachers, we delivered this approach via the didis and bhaiyas of the community. And they worked in their own lane with a group of 5-6 children because, yes, there's COVID, you have to be cautious, you have to maintain distance in a public space. And they engaged with these children and we saw significant improvement. Children could learn to, read simple text, could recognize numbers within a span of, 30, 40, 60 days, depending on however, time these people needed. So it is possible to see impact in the community level, as long as you understand what you are trying to do. Thinking of community as, ultimately I need to get it engaged and all, to what end? I think is a very important point. What do I want my community anchors to do is important, and it should always be driven from an engagement perspective initially in mind, then arriving at, X amount of goal is what I want to achieve, right? And that is the exact activity you need to replicate inside the classroom when schools reopen for that 100-day period. We have done these partnerships with governments of many states, whether at district level or at an entire state level. For example, in a state like UP, within a year, we saw fourth graders' learning levels improve by 30 percentage points, more than that actually, for entire, 75 districts of Uttar Pradesh, with exactly the kind of inputs that government usually puts as well, just that teachers were asked to leave aside their curriculum for a bit and focus on what we call as teaching at the right level methodology. So if that can happen in UP, which is in terms of indicators fairly lagging, right? In terms of governance, it's a huge state. It's very difficult to bring all 75 districts together, right? Smaller states can execute it very easily. And it doesn't even need a lot of state machinery. It needs just a buy-in from the state that they are okay with putting curriculum aside. Then it can be delivered at a very local, grassroots level with almost no expenditure. You already have a teacher in the classroom. You don't need a lot of material. There is existing material in the classroom. You just need to actually focus on this goal as opposed to, the bigger goal. And that's why I have issues with the fact that NAS is about to happen, apparently. Why? I don't understand. What are we going to achieve out of doing NAS when children are coming out of like an 18-month of no school attendance, nothing? So I'm worried it is immediately going to again put us on that track of excellence as opposed to equity, right? Because if you want to achieve equity, the reason why our classrooms are not equitable is because the teacher is teaching from a fifth grade class textbook, while only 10% of my class can actually read it. Everyone else is not actually benefiting from this, and that's why they are the troublemakers in the classroom, because they don't understand what's happening here, right? They'd rather be outside playing in the field, like Professor said, right? It needs to be, it will be equitable only when everyone is benefiting from it, and that will happen when you, when the teacher knows where my child's, what child is at, and what do I need to do with it. So, yeah, that's from my side on this.
Thank you so much, Manushi. So, very interesting discussions I've gone through. I would like to move to the next round, wherein I would like to know about, if you could share your views on the way forward on how do we reimagine education in reopening the schools amid COVID-19. Your brief responses for about a couple of minutes each. I would want to start with Meeta ma'am. You could also share your policy recommendations if you are comfortable. Thank you.
I was hoping to go last this time because there's been so much food for thought and so much validation, I must say, because this is from experience on the ground, from Manushi's team, Sucheta's team, the JNU examples. So much rich input that has come in that I think, one, we must create structural, not institutional, but structural spaces for reflective practice. And as of now, this is something that is being done in organizations such as Pratham and Dreamer Dream, et cetera. But I do not actually see useful spaces for reflective practice that translates into classroom action in the regular teaching and learning spaces. So not just the research bit that I, and the action research that I had encouraged earlier, but for example, in many states, we've had these student teacher circles and they have been implemented really, really well with different goals, with different purposes. So one, I would love to see much more reflective practice built amongst the teacher peer community, because again, it is true that peer communities always collapse. It's okay, we know they will collapse, but there will be a 20% increase in value every time. And one thing we learn in education is to be patient and to say, okay, fine, that collapsed, we're going to build it again. So that is the other thing, which is about building infrastructure. Building infrastructure for success, saying we need to build this long-term infrastructure, which is say the internet, which is saying peer learning circles for mathematics, for chemistry, for sharing whatever has worked in the classroom. And I'm talking specifically from the classroom perspective. But I also would like to call at a structural and policy level, I would like to call for a reconfiguration of the way we run our lessons. I'm using a broad term for it right now called hybrid. Hybrid is a very messy term. It means it's too much of an umbrella term. But for the purpose of this conversation, hybrid. So for example, take the lesson plan. And there's a question over there about how digital pedagogies can be done better. Manushi, you provided amazing examples. But let's talk about a standard class teacher with a lesson plan. If you're trying to do your 40-minute lesson plan with 40 students, assuming that this block of classroom walls is going to the, remain for you and students will not be distracted, it's not going to work. So we're going to need structural restructuring of that. So do only a 15-minute lecture, then let the students go into a group session with support teachers. You have four sections in the classroom. One teacher can do one part, one quarter of the curriculum for teaching. The other three teachers are doing support activities only. So think of it as a Lego structure. You've broken apart the Lego of the lesson plan, and you're rebuilding it in ways that are going to work for remote learning. Again, referring back to Manushi's examples, which are wonderful ways of reconfiguring the session. So structurally think of reconfiguring and including that in your education policies, the implementation advice at least.
Sure. Thank you, ma'am. Sucheta ma'am, over to you.
I think I have already shared, so there's not much to add, Dr. Mehta. I will just reiterate, I think we need to reimagine the purpose of education so that it's fit for the future versus trying to still fix issues of the past, while also addressing systemic stratifications that exist due to, you know, the class, caste, gender differences that come in. So if we can do this, I think that is the way of the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. So I would like to move on to Manushi ma'am for her final comments.
Sure. I also, like Sujita said, I've said what I wanted to say and said quite a bit, already regretting my last remark about NAS. I think that's all I would say, just that try and understand, we can't go back to normal. This whole thing about new normal and all, it's not going to be the same thing that, oh, there was a pause and let's just pick up where we left off, right? There is a need to look at everything, whatever past was there, of course, but whatever children have been through, and start from, think of it as a way to start afresh and address the challenges that are there.
Right. Thank you so much. So I would now request Professor Sachidanand Sinha to share his concluding remarks and also provide perhaps the best practice of education for both students and teachers anywhere in the world. This is a question by Fatima Naz. If you could address this and also provide your concluding remarks briefly, sir. Over to you.
Simi, I have already been summarizing what my colleagues have on the panel have said, and therefore, I've been continuously engaging with some of these observations that came from Meeta, Manushi, Sucheta. I think one thing is absolutely clear that, it's not a kind of a pause, that we got to really reimagine the next step on so many days, months, very differently, so that is the main thing. And there I believe, we have to give the autonomy, a kind of a guided autonomy, whichever way you put it. I really would like to say that, there are teachers, there are groups of students, break them down into what Meeta was saying, that, or Manushi was saying, that there is one teacher does 15 minutes kind of a, then assisted by other teachers. Yeah, this is a very good idea because, while working with, the Kashmiri children, especially with one of my students who was, and you should understand, that it has been 3 decades of existing in a shadow of terrorism or whatever turmoil that, so he did his PhD with me recently. And what we really found out that, what Manushi was saying, that Bhaiya and Didi really worked in their neighborhood, but then it's very interesting that when you have a homogeneous neighborhood and when you have a very different kind of a neighborhood, then the challenges become very different, So, yeah, so what I really would like to contribute and to this is that, there is one size fits all kind of an approach will have to be given up. It will have to be, I think, a very, very disaggregated kind of a micro level interventions, documenting problems, and really coming up with some kind of a solution that is required through what was really referred to as creating a structure, a decentralized kind of a structure outside the classroom. Yet, what Sucheta said, that these children have learned so much. They have learned enormously. How can we really bring those learning into a kind of a set of experiences on which, they could be encouraged to build, so they will say, well, they will also feel very good that, they are not doing something, which is, they will become participants in this whole process. They're not seeing something, which is so external as the curriculum, but there is something, which is organically linked to their day-to-day life, their experiences in the field, or their experiences in the playground, or their experiences at home, and to tackle these multitudes of problems, both emotional and others. Because, we got to really marham bhi lagana hai, aur humko unko thoda sa, kya kehte hai, we have to really also take them in that direction. So, where they feel motivated, and they get back to classrooms. But before classroom, I think, there has to be in each and every locality. And that is what Manushi was saying, that it has to be a locality-based kind of an engagement. You open a school, it's very good. Everything is happening around us. Nobody raises a question. You know, once one day the government says, okay, you know, we are lifting this, we are relaxing it, and you see the kind of crowd that is there in the market, in the streets. But what we really keep closed is the school, you know. Even this attitude of the government or the society and the fear that all of us have children and therefore we are all afraid. And, you know, some of us were not happy when the government decided to open the school. I mean, I know of the kind of conversation that was going on. But, you know, the fact of the matter is that, you know, we cannot really postpone this any longer. And we have to really innovate. We have to really create alternatives. Classroom is one, but I think, you know, the formal education is a much later addition, and the generations which have brought us here did not have the advantage of formal education system. The challenges of the future, what kind of jobs, I think, you know, all these questions will have to be brought into discussion, where we should not be seen as somebody who is now, whose hands are tied, who have only one kind of a framework to look at, and that's the framework of capitalism, make huge money, profit, and market-oriented solutions. Let me tell you, no matter whether you ban Jew, buy Jews or whatever, it's not going to really help us, because, you know, there is a larger community, nearly about 68 to 70% of them, they are not even looking at Baijus, you know. So therefore, I mean, what I'm really talking about is that, you know, innovations would keep happening. How the government and community, and that's where the responsibility of the government is. You know, the responsibility of the government is not to only manage law and order, but in fact, that is the directive principles of the state policy. And now we have RTE. They have the responsibility. They can't just really shut their eyes and doors and say, we are not concerned about it. You know, they will have to bring in all these innovations and make them available for the people to choose, for the teachers to choose. And I think, you know, that is where the solution lies. So I think, you know, it was an excellent contribution from our panelists. I'm really indebted to all of them, because, you know, it has really made me learn a lot. And thanks, Impri, for giving me this opportunity, Arjun, Simi, and your colleagues. I don't know whether I did a good job or a bad job.
Awesome. But
there is always a scope for improvement. And could be there, maybe there is a next time. Thank you very much.
Yes, so
but it was nice meeting Meeta and Manushi and Sucheta. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Absolutely, we are so grateful to you. So I would like to propose the formal vote of thanks on behalf of the IMPRI Center for ICT and Development at Impact and Policy Research Institute. Thank you to our chair, Professor Sachidanand Sinha, for your wonderful contributions to the very important discussion. Actually, we are all affected directly and indirectly by the whole situation. And I would also like to thank our panelists, Manushi ma'am, Sucheta ma'am, and Meeta ma'am. It was so wonderful listening to all of you, knowing your work experiences and your perspectives. And unfortunately, Piyush sir was not able to join us because of an urgent meeting. He sent us an email sometime back. So, and also the questions that we received from the participants, it really shows the importance of the challenge that is at hand, and we all need to go through it. So thank you so much to all the participants who joined us here on Zoom, and also those who are watching us on Facebook Live, and to all those who will be watching us later on YouTube and listening to the program on our different podcasts. So thank you so much, and I wish you all a very good evening. Have a good day. Take care.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.